Hi, everybody. So I'm going to be picking up on basically where Brian and Eli left off. You'll see a lot of the same themes recurring, which I think is good. So as we know, there are a lot of debates and polarized viewpoints in the field right now about what the right way is to do research, right? One person says the ideal or correct set of best practices looks like this. Somebody else says, no, they look like that. And they argue. They often argue loudly. Meanwhile, for people who aren't in the center of those debates, and that's most of the people in the field right now, right? The polarizing arguments, the shifting standards and policies at our journals and societies, the lack of consensus about what the right thing is to do, and the idea even that there is one right thing can make people feel like they just have to sit helplessly on the sidelines and wait to see what happens. You may be motivated to change your research, you want to do your science better, but you're not exactly sure what to do. And maybe you feel a little afraid too, right? Afraid of doing the wrong thing or saying the wrong thing. So maybe it feels like the best thing to do is just to stop moving and keep your head down, stay quiet, and wait to see how things shake out. Well, today I'm going to argue that you do not need to wait to start improving your science, that you can and should start today if you haven't already, and that you are the best person to figure out the most effective way to do that. And I'm going to suggest that it is absolutely crucial for us in this context to distinguish between this goal that we all share of improving our science and the various means that might potentially help us to achieve that goal. As Eli noted, there's many possible means, right? So one way to improve my science is by increasing my power. And one way to do that is by increasing my sample size, by moving my studies online so I can get access to a larger subject pool. A completely different way to go about increasing my power would be to boost the strength of the manipulations in my study. And maybe I work in a research area where it's possible to do both of those at once, and both are effective. That's great. But maybe it's more complicated. Maybe I need to pay close attention to whether those means actually help me to effectively reach my goal, right? Maybe I go and I put my in-lab manipulation online only to find that it's much less strong. So my power has actually decreased rather than increased by moving from the lab to an online study. So given that there are these multiple possible means to achieving this goal, how do we choose between them? Should we decide on the best means for the field as a whole, or should we focus on ourselves, what works best in our lab? We could try to decide on the best means for the field as a whole, but we run the risk of what Eli just called trade-off neglect, either because we conflate the goal and the means, or because we just don't see the obstacles and constraints that exist in other areas of research. One size does not fit all here, and we might be especially bad at fitting sizes to research areas that we aren't very familiar with. An alternative strategy, then, is to acknowledge that there are multiple potential means and to focus on what works best in our own labs. In other words, to start with where we have the most expertise. Moreover, you could argue that part of the reason why our research practices have been suboptimal is because they haven't been linked strongly enough, closely enough, with the goal of getting it right. Right? So the approach that I'm going to be suggesting today of starting local, starting with what we know, is really about, at its heart, asking yourself the question, what enables me to get it right in my own research? What enables me to improve my science, to trust my results more, to accumulate information that over time will converge on truth? So what happens when we ask ourselves, what's the best way to maximize the informational value of the research that I do in my particular research context? And what happens when we listen to what other people say in answer to that question, even if it's not exactly the same thing that we would say? So in my own lab a few years ago, we started asking ourselves this question. We asked, what makes us confident in our own results? We said, let's take what we know now, and what we're thinking about more explicitly now, about things like power and p-hacking and meta-analysis and new and newly rediscovered tools like sequential analyses. And let's use them to distinguish better between findings that we would ourselves trust a lot versus findings that we would only trust more tentatively. In other words, let's try to distinguish between what we've ended up calling in our lab higher confidence versus lower confidence findings. The intuition behind this distinction goes something like this. Imagine that you run a study and you find a cool result, and that's great. And then your RA comes up to you and says, oh, you know that study that you had me run? Well, I accidentally ran it twice. Here's the second data set. Your affective gut reaction in that moment tells you whether that was a high trust or a low trust finding in the first data set. If you are overjoyed at the prospect of a free replication, then that was a high trust finding. If you kind of feel a little bit anxious about opening up that second data set because, gosh, maybe you just got lucky the first time and you won't get so lucky the second time, that's a low confidence finding. You might want to replicate it before you placed a lot of trust in it. All right, so we wanted to develop a set of research practices in our lab that would enable us to better distinguish between these higher versus lower confidence findings. And I want to stress here that what comes out of this kind of process is going to depend on your particular area of research. Do you work with small, tightly controlled 2x2 experiments like we do in my lab, or do you work with big pre-existing data sets or run big intervention studies? It's also going to depend on what you're comfortable with doing at this point in time and what's feasible for you, what your resources are and what your constraints are. So here's the process, though, because I think the process can generalize across different contexts better than the outcome. So the process for us basically had three parts, and each part is ongoing. This is iterative. We keep working on it. The first part of the process was to hold a series of lab meetings or journal clubs, which are like lab meetings but with booze, so they're better. And we went out and read the new stuff coming out that suggests various possible means for improving research. We go to conference presentations and learn what people are saying about different ideas for dealing with different problems. And we talk about them. And we critically evaluate them. So we take all the possible means and we say, which of these makes sense? Is this new statistical tool or a newly rediscovered methodological practice, is that going to make sense in our lab? Is it really new and maybe we want to wait to see if it's vetted a bit before adopting it? Or does it seem like it would give us a better handle on what our results are telling us? Can we adapt some of these to work better in our lab? And if so, how would we do that? Based on those discussions, we developed and continue to refine a set of shared research practices for our lab. And as we're developing these practices, we're focused on this goal of what maximizes the information we get from our research. But we also keep in mind what our resource limitations are. What are we able to do given how much money we have or don't have and how big our sample size is, our subject population? And we pay attention to what's comfortable and feasible for us to do right now. As Brian said earlier, the point here wasn't to get from okay to perfect in a day. The point was to take a step in the right direction, right? And then another step in the right direction to start moving. And so when we thought about, yeah, gosh, it'd be great if all of our data sets were very clearly organized and labeled, let's go back through all of our data sets that we've ever run in the history of the lab and reorganize them. And that's not feasible. We were never going to do that. But making a few small, straightforward changes starting today and going forward, that we could do. And so that's what we did. So for instance, a lot of the discussions in our lab at the beginning centered around the issue of sample sizes. And we decided that for us, we wanted to start setting our target ends ahead of time. We could look at the data as it comes in. I think there are some real benefits to doing that. But we couldn't stop early before we reached our target cell size if we wanted to be able to place high trust in the outcome of that study. We do power analyses when possible based on previous findings or ideally a meta-analysis. And we try to do power analyses that take into account effect size heterogeneity and publication bias, since ignoring these things can lead a classic power analysis, like the kind you do in G-Power, to substantially underestimate the number of people you need in your study. When we can't do a power analysis, and often we can't, we do basic research. We have no idea if the effect is there, and if it is there, how big it is, right? So we have no idea what effect size to expect. When we can't do a power analysis, we set a target cell size. That's pretty arbitrary, but we decided that our minimum target cell size, the smallest that can get for a given study in our lab, is going to be 50 people per cell. Why an N of 50? Is that because it's a magical, sacred, beautiful number that all of you should go out and start using today because I said it was right? No. 50 is completely 100% arbitrary, but it's better than, it worked better, we were more comfortable with it than the previous heuristic minimum sample size we were using in our lab, which was an N of 20. Here's why we weren't comfortable with this heuristic anymore. With an N of 20 in a simple two-group design, your power to detect a small effect is less than 10%. That's a woefully small hit rate. But worse than that, for us anyway, is that when power dips below 10%, you're not only likely to overestimate your effect size by a lot if you find a significant result, you may get the sign in the wrong direction. So we could run a study and see that our manipulation increased our dependent variable when in reality in the population, it decreased it. We didn't want to run studies where we could get the answer that wrong. Your power to detect a medium size effect with an N of 20 in a two-group design is 34%, which is, again, very, very low. And when power gets below 50%, you start having big effect size exaggeration problems. So your results are less informative. You're not learning as much as you could from them. With an N of 50, it's not perfect, but things get better. So your power to detect a small effect is still very low, but at least you're avoiding those sign problems that I just mentioned. And your power to detect a medium-sized effect is pretty decent. It's 70%, and you're avoiding those effect size exaggeration problems. Note that when we say that we will only run to a cell size of 50, this is in effect a power analysis in the sense that we're defining a minimum effect size of interest, or it makes more sense to me to think of it as it's the resources we're willing to spend. We're saying we're only interested in this effect if we can detect it with this amount of resources. And that's sometimes how we make these decisions. This effect would be super, super cool if we got it, so let's throw an N of 100 at it. This effect would be cool, but I'd rather study something else, so let's set our minimum cell size smaller. Okay, so the third part of the process is also very important, which is to develop an infrastructure that will enable us to make these changes effectively and easily on a day-to-day basis. And so we now have an experiment archive form in our lab that usually my graduate students fill out for every study that they run. It takes them a few minutes, that's a trade-off, but it actually ultimately saves us a lot of time, and you'll see why in just a moment. The archive form includes things like the planned total sample size and the rationale for that sample size. Was it based on a power analysis? Was it an arbitrary choice ahead of time? It includes any a priori inclusion or exclusion criteria that we want to be able to say we set and recorded ahead of time and to know when we look back later that we actually did that. And any a priori analyses that we want to run, so a pre-analysis plan of the sort that Brian was talking about before. This is online if you want it on our lab website, the address at the bottom of the screen. People have said that it's useful for starting something like this in their lab if they want to. And for us, this form goes in a folder with the carefully labeled materials for the study, a carefully labeled data file, and a carefully labeled syntax file, all in a centralized location on our shared lab drive. What that means is that if you go back to the data a month, or a year, or 5 years later, or your student or collaborator graduates and falls off the face of the earth, and you're wondering whatever happened to that cool study that you ran, you don't have to spend hours and hours slogging through a bunch of files trying to figure out where it was, and was the data file called final or final trimmed really final or some other version complete final really final with capitals is actually more final, you don't know. And you don't have to figure out why is this script that I'm running not producing exactly the same result that I remember seeing the first time I ran it, right? It's all there with a click of a button, everything runs, it's easy to send to people if they're doing a meta-analysis or they want to replicate you, and this has already saved us hours and hours of time, even though it just takes a few minutes to fill out each section as you go. Okay, so I've been over here focusing on what makes my research better, given my particular area of research and my particular research context. But if you face different constraints, you might be focusing on a completely different set of issues and developing different strategies. So for instance, researchers who work with large, hard-to-collect data sets face a totally different set of questions and constraints and opportunities when they ask themselves the question, what makes us confident in our results? Right, so I run, as I said, a lot of two-by-two experiments. When I think about how to improve my research practices, I think about issues like, how do I boost my sample size? what should I do about optional stopping? How can I use tools like sequential analysis or P augmented to account for that and avoid inflating my type 1 error? When should I run a quick direct replication to check that an initial exploratory finding in study 1 is really there? But if you do interventions in schools, or you run daily diary studies, or you work with big public opinion data sets, or you study the development of kids or close relationships, then you're going to be thinking about a completely different set of questions. You might be thinking, okay, I have the resources to collect this one really important sample. How do I make it count? How do I make sure I learn everything that I possibly can from this data set? Because I'm not going to get another chance to do this again. I have to learn it now if I'm ever going to learn it. If it's a longitudinal study, how can I minimize attrition over time? If I am running a daily diary study, should I add a video component? How do I make sure that I'm triangulating on the constructs of interest? Should I assess many concepts with a few items or a few concepts with many items? And by the way, I figured these questions out by talking to people who do this research because I don't do it, and so I don't think of these questions, right? You have to go talk to the people who do this stuff. Okay, and then once somebody who works with this kind of data has their results, they might think of the question of, well, do other people's data sets show the same thing? And if so, how do I find out? And if not, how do I distinguish between that meaning that my finding was a fluke, a type 1 error, versus there's something unique and important about the population that I studied or about my measures that I really need to investigate? And because we're thinking about such different issues depending on our research landscape, we'll probably come up with very different ideas, different solutions, different strategies to try. So if I'm thinking about issues of replication from my 2x2 experiment land perspective, I might think of a many labs approach, right? We can run a whole bunch of studies that replicate this fairly simple two-group experiment, maybe online, and get this lovely distribution of effect size estimates that helps us really understand that effect. Or I might think of the registered replication report mechanism at Perspectives that allows a researcher to propose to replicate a past already published finding. And then if the proposed protocol for replicating that finding is approved, several people follow that protocol and the results of those replications are published regardless of their outcome. Or I might think about journals that ask researchers to pre-register a finding before they begin collecting data for publication in that outlet. But if I live over here in large data set land, I might think of a completely different idea. I might say, you know, what I really want to do is to validate a potentially important finding that I see in my big, costly data set. The idea of pre-registering a single confirmatory test before I began collecting data 10 years ago, or the idea of running a quick direct replication to make sure that one finding checks out, these ideas are completely foreign to me. They are not relevant to my research landscape. It's like they arrive from a different planet, right? What I really want to be able to do is to say, okay, here's this thing that I found by looking in my data set, by learning as much as I possibly could from it. Here's this pattern. I'm pretty confident that it's there because these different analytic strategies all triangulate on the same pattern, right? It's not an artifact of one particular way of analyzing the data. It's not an artifact of looking at one item versus another, but what I'd really like to be able to do right now is figure out who are the four other people on Earth who have a similar costly data set who could actually test this question in their data and get them to test it. So maybe you would think we should develop a mechanism that would enable researchers to do that. We could call it the Many Data Sets Collaborative Report, or probably there's a better title, I'm terrible at titles. But it could work like this. It could work where a researcher who works with this kind of data submits a potentially important finding that's vetted for being theoretically important and methodologically sound. And then if it is, a call goes out, it wouldn't have to go out for very long, asking any researchers with similar data sets to register that they have a data set where you could test the same question. So I have this data set, I have these items that could be used to test the question, this is the analysis I would run and I haven't looked yet. And then if that's approved, it gets reviewed, right? If that's approved, they go and they look. And then everything, the initial finding and these almost instantaneous replications get published together, regardless of the outcome, in a single paper. All right, so these are two very different landscapes that produce different ideas. There are obviously a lot more. if you're at a small undergraduate institution with, you know, a tiny subject pool where you're conducting your studies and you're trying to mentor probably a lot of undergraduates in research by getting them directly involved in all these different phases of the research process, you're probably facing a completely different set of constraints. So, again, if I live in my world, which is big university land, and I'm thinking about how to improve my power, I might think of ideas like I should increase my sample size, and maybe I should run stuff online. And then I might stop thinking because that works just fine in my research context. But if I live in small college land, I'm not thinking about those strategies, those means. They don't make much sense in my landscape. I can't do them. So I might instead think about all the other many tools that we might have at our disposal to increase our power that don't depend on sample size. I could run within subjects designs, which would give me a huge boost to power without actually changing my N at all, even. I could think about crafting stronger manipulations so that the effect that I'm studying is actually larger, right? And therefore, power goes up. I'm more likely to see it. I could think about maximizing the reliability of my scales. If I am using a measured variable as a predictor in my study, then the reliability of that measured predictor matters a lot in determining the power of my study. I could consider treating stimuli as random factors. If I run sequential primary experiments, or I show participants a target individual or a series of target individuals and have them rate those targets, then I am drawing stimuli from a population of potential stimuli in the same way that we all draw participants from a population of potential participants. And those should actually be treated as a random factor. If you do that, if you take that into account in your design and analyses, then often power depends more on the number of stimuli you have in your study than the number of participants. And increasing the number of stimuli is often easier than increasing the number of participants if you're in this research context. I could choose good covariates. I have to be careful if I do that, that I'm not inflating my type 1 error by just throwing a bunch of covariates in and seeing what happens. But there's a way to do this in a way that holds your type 1 error down, right? If you plan this stuff out ahead of time and write it down, record it. And that boosts your power quite a bit if your covariate is soaking up a lot of noise that would otherwise be unaccounted for in your dependent variable. And I could think of new ideas like a cross-site collaborative meta-analysis, right? Maybe I have access, if I run all year, to 50 whole participants. But maybe I also have three colleagues at other institutions who also have access to 50 participants. And if we all run a similar study, we could then pool our results and aggregate them into a meta-analysis that was adequately powered to test our effect. Meanwhile, for people at a big university, right, you might look at this long list of other strategies and say, hey, I want to do some of those too, right? I don't want to put everything online. I would also like to use within subjects designs and craft strong manipulations because that would work in my research context. Those would be effective means in my research context as well. Okay, so what does this start local approach get us? Well, I think there are two clear ringing benefits to taking this approach. The first is that our own research gets better, and it gets better right away. We don't have to wait for field-wide change or for agreement on shared field-wide standards to start reaping the benefits of improving our science. So for instance, here's just one example of what our own local change in research practices in our lab has gotten us. This was a study that my student Jahan Sparks, who's standing right there, ran, and she was interested in whether, to simplify a lot, the bar on the right would be higher, would show greater attitude change than the bar on the left. So we ran a study, and we found that it was. Okay, this was under our new research practices, so we had high confidence in this finding. And then we thought, let's tweak a few things about the scenario to make sure the result would generalize across different particularities of the scenario we were using. We ran another study, we expected to see the same thing, and we didn't. The effect went away. In fact, if anything, it went slightly in the other direction. So that initial finding was definitely not there. Now, in the olden days, we would have thrown up our hands and said, let's go study something that's less temperamental, because I have no idea what's going on here, right? Or let's run a study three tiebreaker study, as if our studies are like in some sort of democracy and they can vote on where the real effect is, and we'll just take whoever gets the most votes as being reality. But because we were using these new research practices, we had high trust in both of these findings. So we didn't do either of those things. We trusted that study one was really there, and we trusted that those study two results were really there as well. And so what that enabled us to do was to go back to the materials and look for any unintended tiny differences that might be more meaningful than we had initially thought. We went back to the literature and looked for potential theoretically derived moderators that might explain why we would get these different effects. We found one that seemed promising. We designed a third study to manipulate that moderator to see if we could reproduce this discrepancy, and we did. So in the first condition of the moderator, we found results that looked like what we saw in study one. In the second condition of the moderator, we found results that looked like what we saw in study two. This moderator is really cool and new and theoretically generative, and we never would have found it using our old research practices. It was all because we were using these new ones. Okay, so our new practices do that. They also save us time and resources. We go on fewer wild goose chases, chasing after a study one effect with a study two and a study three and a study four, only to realize that, you know what, the first study was probably just a false positive. We run fewer inconclusive studies. When we see a null finding, we're more likely to trust that it's really there rather than, oh, maybe we just didn't do this right, maybe we just didn't have enough power to see the effect. And we spend far less time, as I showed you earlier, mucking around looking for through old data files, trying to recover old analyses. More broadly, we get to trust our data more. We get to learn more from the work that we do. We get to feel more like scientific detectives out to figure out what reality is. And that's been enormously rewarding and fulfilling. So the first benefit to a start local approach is that our own research gets better right away. The second benefit, I think, is that we begin to accrue much needed information as a field about what works and what doesn't work in each particular research context. So for instance, we've been using this lab archive form. I'll go through this a bit quickly, but some things really work great for us about this form. Some things don't work so well. And so we keep mucking with it. We keep editing things to try to address the issues that we find, to try to make it work better over time than it does. Here's another example. Let's say you study self-affirmation, and you have this great manipulation of self-affirmation in the lab. It's very strong. It produces a big effect size. Participants get really into the manipulation. They write an essay for about 8 minutes. It's very impactful. And you decide you would like to boost your power, so you're going to move your manipulation online so you can use mTurk participants, only to find that when participants do this manipulation online, they write all of 2 sentences. They don't spend any time with it at all, and you have a much weaker effect. Right? So you thought you were going to boost your power by increasing your N, when in fact you may have actually lost a lot of power because your manipulation got so much weaker, as was, I think, the case in one of the studies in the reproducibility project. So once we learn about what works and what doesn't work in different research contexts, we can use that accumulated knowledge to inform the development of field-wide standards that are appropriately nuanced across a variety of different contexts. So in closing, I just want to go back to this idea of distinguishing between this goal that we all share and the various possible means that might help us to achieve it, and to reiterate that these means may look very different in different contexts. What's effective in one context might not be effective in another. The more we figure out what works and what doesn't work, what's effective and feasible in our own labs, the better able we're going to be to develop a set of shared standards that are effective and applicable for everybody, not just people who happen to do exactly the same kind of research that we do. So there's not one right answer here. There are many good answers. And our job, your job today, is to go out and start figuring out what are some of the good answers within your particular research landscape. Okay, with that, I should acknowledge my lab, who are the ones who are actually implementing the research practices that I discussed, and also say thank you to all of these sources of nuance in my thinking. And thank you for listening. Questions? I also brought, if you want, and I'll put these up online too. Somebody was asking about, like, what can you actually do? And these are some of many great resources for actual concrete tools that you can use, that you can see if it would work with your research context to improve the informational value of your work. Yeah.
Hi, Alison. So I want to thank you for this talk. I'm a denizen of a small college, so I appreciate you mentioning some of the challenges. I would add to some of that, if I could, just to say that, for one, I'm able to use that term, and I think that that's probably the case for other folks at small colleges where we have a little bit of a land budget every year or something like that. We do have startup. It's not $100,000, but it's something, right? I say a little thank you to Burmeister and Gosling today because I wouldn't have tenure if it wasn't for that paper. So that is, I think, for some people an option. I've also found that, and you mentioned these big data sets, and that's the kind of stuff that you can use when you're at a small place, right? So I use GSS and the ADS for a lot of my work as well, and maybe I'll try to validate some of the findings we get from there with some capital term studies or some stuff inside of our participant. So just, I'm imagining that there's a number of people here, a number of people that already mentioned, I'm going to be on the job market soon, and can't all be at large R1 institutions, and so it's keep in mind that you can do some of these good practices at small places too, as you mentioned. Mm-hmm. There's other ways to do this as well. I teach a research methods course, and we're able to take the lessons that we've learned about replication. Instead of trying to invent 16 different projects, we focus on trying to replicate one paper. Mm-hmm. So just some things to think about.
I think those are great ideas, yeah.
That was really interesting. I really like the idea of being more context specific by looking at different research areas and what we might all need. I'm also wondering, do you think there are any recommendations that we should all implement that are more general and universal?
That's a great question. I think stay very broad, kind of like Eli did, and say I would say that the principle is the universal thing, the goal is the universal thing, that we should all be more focused on figuring out what's true and what's right and discovering the answers, and isn't that why we all got into science in the first place, right? And be a little bit more aware of when that goal may be. Brian's paper on this was great, right? Of when that goal may be being overridden by I'd really like to get a job and I'd really like to get tenure and I'd really like to get, and those goals, those keep going. It's not like you get a job and then all of a sudden you're free to do whatever without thinking about it, right? Then you need tenure and then you have students who need jobs. So what you're doing actually impacts the students. And so I think while I totally sympathize with, I can't do this right now because I need to get to this next step, there's no waiting on this. Like, there will always be things that are getting in the way of you trying to do them, and that's not to say that you don't have it easier if you have tenure already, but I don't wait, because there's always a reason to put off changing or to for it to be hard. So I do think that we should all be thinking about this goal of what actually makes me trust my results and take a good, long, hard look at, do I actually trust these results, right? Do that if you run a study. Do that experiment in your head, and if somebody brought me a second replication that was run by me at exactly the same time, would I bet money on seeing the result? Do I actually trust this result that much? Or if you work with a big data set, do a version where somebody else has the identical data set and they look in theirs. And then try to figure out what are some of the strategies out there that would help you answer that question in the affirmative more often. Yeah, Kyle.
So in my lab, we've been exploring just different ways to improve our practices. I've had conversations with you and some of your suggestions, and you've been a template in terms of how we should go about this. But one thing we've been doing, we've been trying pre-registration, also improving kind of our sample size. And we have experienced issues with kind of resource trade-offs, right? So we're running kind of large samples, and then you can't really do kind of these other studies that you were maybe hoping to do. So that's kind of influenced us in ways of like trying to put other measures into our kind of big studies to get kind of exploratory analyses that we can then run kind of confirmatory analyses. And I'm wondering, as you've tried to increase your sample size, kind of the pressures that you felt in terms of, okay, now we have these confirmatory analyses that were pre-registered, and we have all these exploratory things, and then we're trying to think about, when we write up the paper, can we just kind of point to our open science pre-registration and say, like, if you want to see kind of the full, kind of everything we included in there that were exploratory, go there, or in our paper, we have to kind of, I guess in the name of transparency, and I know people have different views on this, do you put everything in there? So I guess one of my questions is, kind of, as you've kind of started putting new practices into place, what are some of the challenges, kind of where the rubber meets the road, particularly as like increasing sample size?
Yeah, so there are definitely trade-offs with increasing our sample size. I love it because we trust our findings more, right? But we've lost something. So I was just talking to Alexa and Vivka about, as we've been running these bigger studies that and more close replications, right? We'll do a direct replication of our own finding to really trust it if we didn't have the whole thing planned out ahead of time, which often we don't. And then we tweak it a little bit and see what happens, and sometimes we find really cool moderators, right? But we're staying closer to the original paradigm, partly because if we're gonna spend that many participants on this, we don't wanna have an inconclusive study where we have no idea, is it because of this change or that change or the other one? So we have this great paper, in my opinion, that came out of one of these lines of research that I love and I trust a lot, and I am sure those effects are there. But you know what we didn't do as much of as we used to do at all is conceptual replications. So I'm not nearly as confident that the conceptual variable underlying the manipulation is what we think it is as I would have used to, would have been. That's grammatical. So I think that's one place where we struggle, and we're like, yeah, conceptual replications are still hugely important. We want to do that, so we're doing more of those now. The whole thing is taking much longer. So thank goodness the student on that project was first or second year when we started, because it wouldn't be done in time, right? That's a trade-off. I happened to have a set of younger students starting at that time, but I think if I'd had like a student who's about to go on the market, that would have been hard. What else? I think writing a paper has gotten more challenging, much more challenging. It took a lot longer to write the last two papers that I wrote, and they are longer, and we're using a lot of footnotes, and I love footnotes passionately, and there have always been a lot of footnotes in my papers, but now there's even more footnotes in my papers. But there's a lot of, like, we ran a replication study where we changed this one thing and the results came out similarly, but you don't need to like read the whole thing. Like we ran it and it's in a footnote, and you can ask, or we could put it online, right? All the information about it if people wanted it. So it was a kind of fun challenge to write those papers in a way that was like complete and transparent. And in one of them, we didn't have the prediction to start with at all. So how do we foreshadow the possibilities without saying that we predicted them? And so that's what we did. We said there's different possibilities. You might expect from this literature that this would happen. You might expect from that literature that that would happen. And then here's a third possibility, and maybe it's some of all of them, and then you find out in the paper. But those kinds of things have been challenging to do.
I really like this idea that the best solutions depend on your particular research questions and what you study. I was just wondering what you think about, like, is it possible that there are certain types of questions where there's just no good way to increase your confidence in the results that you get? Like, I study really small effects in a developmental lab. They are really costly. Should we not be asking those questions? Or, like, should I move on to something else? Like, what's the... Is it like, if we can't be confident in the results, is it worse to ask the questions and get answers that we're not sure about?
I don't think so. I want people out there asking the challenging questions. I think this is an old problem in the sense that there's always been like the low-hanging fruit. You could get it if you ran a simple survey study questions out there that some people pursue, including myself. And then there are the really challenging, like, let's get people to do something crazy, like talk to each other in person, and we like measure stuff about that. And I really hope people keep doing that, right? But there's always been a that goes slower problem. And now it's magnified because it goes slower and you're supposed to have way higher power in your studies. And if you're trying to increase your sample size to do that, then and that gets really hard. So I think that, I really hope that people keep asking those questions. And I really hope that we as a field make room for that kind of research and place value on that kind of research. I don't think you should be saying I had 10 people and I did some exploratory stuff and this is definitely there, right? But I had 10 people or 20 people or 30 people and here's what I did to maximize power as much as I could and here's the full disclosure on the different things that I tried and here's what I think I've learned, but it's tentative, it's an idea. And I would really love it if other people would follow up on it. I want there to be room in our science for that kind of stuff because it seems hugely important to me.